In this video, we introduce converging lenses, starting with a qualitative look at the refractions that cause parallel rays to converge to a focal point, how to determine the focal length of the lens, how to identify the principal rays in a lens analysis, how to use ray diagrams to find real and virtual images, and how to calculate the location and magnification of an image using the thin lens equation. Finally, we wrap things up with quantitative examples of real and virtual images formed by a convex lens. So that's a lot to do in a single video, so I divided everything up into chapters so you can skip around and find what you need. We start by qualitatively discussing how a converging lens works. On the left side, we have a thin convex lens with parallel rays of light coming into the lens, parallel to its principal axis. So that's the special name given to the symmetry axis of the lens. Refractions in the lens bend all these rays toward the principal axis, bringing them together at a single point called the focal point. Because a convex lens causes these parallel rays to converge, it's also called a converging lens. On the right, we have a picture of one particular ray showing why it gets refracted toward the principal axis of the lens. Recall that when light passes from air into glass or plastic, it will refract toward the normal line because the index of refraction has increased. So that's what happens at this first contact. You can see the refracted ray is closer to the normal line than the incident ray. Then in the second refraction, we're passing from the glass or plastic back into the air, so the index of refraction has decreased, and the light ray refracts away from the normal line. So by the time that light ray emerges from the lens, it's been bent toward the principal axis. If the lens has spherical surfaces, then parallel rays coming into the lens will all refract to that single focal point. A little side note at this point is that we often talk about lenses in terms of their power. And the larger the power is, the stronger the lens is. In other words, it's going to cause all these rays to converge to a nearer focal point. So power is defined as 1 over the focal length. The units of optical power are 1 over meters. And this is given a special name. These are called diopters. So we'll wrap up this chapter with a simple example. Compute the power in diopters for a convex lens with a focal length of 10 centimeters. So all you do is just take 1 over f. Just put it in the right units, so 0.1 meters. And I get 10 inverse meters, or 10 diopters, for the power. Suppose you have a converging lens and you want to find the focal length. One way to do this is to use the best set of parallel rays we can find, and those are rays coming from the sun. Because the sun is so far away, rays of sunlight are almost perfectly parallel. So you might hold your lens in the sunlight and move it up and down over a target until these rays focus to a single point. The distance above the target then tells you the focal length. Sunlight is intense enough to start a fire if it's concentrated in this way, so be careful as you're experimenting. So in reality, what you've formed from the rays of the sun is not really a single point. It's an image of the sun. And you can find the focal length of a convex lens by focusing any image onto a target, provided the object you're using for the image is far enough away for the light rays to strike the lens nearly parallel. Note, however, in the second picture, that an object off the principal axis will form an image off the principal axis. So I'm just focusing on a tiny point on a tree here, just a single leaf. Those rays are coming in parallel to the lens, and they're going to focus an image of the leaf off the axis. So we define the focal plane to be the plane on which distant objects will form an image, and this plane is at the same distance f from the lens. So without risking a fire, you can simply project an image on your wall by opening a window and making an image of a distant tree. When the image focuses, the distance between the lens and the wall is the focal length. When we study lenses, we usually want to find the image formed as the light from an object passes through the lens. We can use a ray diagram to draw the process. We focus on three principal rays that refract in a very simple way through the lens. First, a ray coming into the lens parallel to the principal axis will be refracted through the focus on the opposite side of the lens. The second ray is the time reversal of the first. So light coming into the lens through the focus will be refracted parallel to the principal axis. Finally, a ray passing through the center of the lens will be unrefracted, because the two surfaces that it passes through on the lens, on its way in and on its way out, are parallel to each other. So to find an image formed by an object, we start with the basic assumption that light is scattered off the object in all directions all the time. So we can choose any ray we like for the analysis. We represent the object with an arrow, in order to keep track of the orientation, and we represent a converging lens as a line with two arrowheads that give you a hint as to the curvature of the lens. There are two basic cases for the image formed by a convex lens, and the first is when the object is outside the focus. We choose principal rays emanating from the head of the arrow, and then we try to find out where those rays focus after passing through the lens. Wherever those rays come together, that's where the image of the head of the arrow will form. And we draw the rest of the arrow perpendicular to the principal axis, and we've got our image. We start with the ray that's coming in parallel to the principal axis. And that's going to be refracted through the focus on the opposite side. Next, we pick a ray that's coming through the focus on the near side. And that's going to be refracted parallel to the principal axis. Finally, we take a ray through the center of the lens just to verify that it agrees with the first two. And we see all three of those rays meeting at the same point. And that's the point at which the image of the head of the arrow will focus, and we obtain our image. Note, first of all, that the image is inverted. And second, that the actual light rays are converging to form this image. That means we could project this image onto a piece of paper, and this type of image is called a real image. The second case for a converging lens is when the object is inside the focus. And we're going to see radically different behavior in this case. So we use the same sorts of principal rays. I have one coming in parallel to the principal axis, and that gets refracted through the focus on the opposite side. I have one coming through the center of the lens, and that's unrefracted. And if a ray comes into the lens from the direction of the near side focus, so like in this direction, and there is no ray right here, so we're going to turn that into a dotted line, then it will be refracted parallel to the principal axis. What we notice is that on the far side of the lens, we have a bunch of rays that are diverging from each other, so these can't possibly focus to form a real image in the same way we got for the first case. Well, normally when we view an object, we're viewing diverging rays that are coming off in all directions from that object, and our eye focuses those rays into an image. And where you perceive the object to be is where all these rays have a common origin. So we're going to trace them back to a common origin. And we found a single point that acts as a common origin for all these diverging rays. So what you're going to see if you look through this lens is an enlarged upright image of the object. Now, because these rays are not actually converging and we can't actually project the image onto a screen, it's called a virtual image. So there's our two cases. When the object is outside the focus of the converging lens, we end up with an inverted real image on the opposite side. When the object is inside the focal point of the converging lens, we end up with an upright virtual image on the same side of the lens as the object. Finally, we want to get quantitative with the image formed by a lens. So what we're doing here is defining all the sign conventions for where the object is, where the image is, for the focal length, and then a couple simple equations to help us get the image distance and the magnification for the object. So by convention, I'm always going to put the object on the left side of the lens. The object distance will be positive as long as the object is on the left side of the lens. And you should be aware there are rare cases where we have a virtual object in a lens combination where the object appears on the opposite side of the lens. And I'll post a link to an example of that once I've got it done. The image distance, the convention here, is that it will be positive if it's on the right side of the lens, in other words, opposite the object. Negative if it's on the left side or the same side as the object. The focal length by convention is positive for convex lenses. And finally, using all these sign considerations, the image distance, the object distance, and the focal length are all related by the thin lens equation. So provided these lenses are thin enough, this will give you the approximate location of the image. Finally, a little note on magnification. So magnification is a way of talking about how much bigger or smaller the image is compared to the object. And that's given by the image height divided by the object height, where the sign convention is that the image height is negative if the image is inverted, positive if it's upright. And as it turns out, magnification can be written in terms of the image distance and object distance as negative image distance over object distance. So this means that images on the opposite side of the lens from the object, those have positive image distances, remember, those are going to have negative magnifications. In other words, they're inverted. And we already saw an example of this, where for an object outside the focal length of a converging lens, The image is formed on the opposite side of the lens, but the magnification is negative because the object is flipped upside down. Finally, we look at a couple typical examples of image formation by a convex lens, and we're getting quantitative with it now. So our instructions here are to solve for the image distance and magnification in each of the following cases, and the ray diagrams have been provided. So just reviewing the ray diagram real quick for the first one. I have a focal length of 10 centimeters. I have an object distance of 16 centimeters. By convention, those are both positive values. And then my ray diagram is constructed by taking a parallel ray to the principal axis. That's refracted through the focal point on the opposite side. A ray through the center of the lens, that's unrefracted. And a ray coming through the near side focus, and that's refracted parallel to the principal axis. Again, you only really need two of these rays, but the third one is there to confirm that the first two were done correctly. And what we're trying to get out of this is the image distance. And once we have that, we'll be able to plug that in and get a magnification as well. So we write down the thin lens equation, 1 over di plus 1 over do is equal to 1 over f. So 1 over di is equal to 1 over f minus 1 over do. We can just work in centimeters here. Get 1 over 10 because the focal length is 10 minus 1 over 16. So to solve for di, I'm going to take 1 over 10 minus 1 over 16 and then take 1 divided by that answer to get the reciprocal. And I get an image distance of 26.7 centimeters out of this. Now, if you're very careful in your ray diagram, you can verify by looking at your picture that your answer is approximately correct. And I tried to scale this reasonably. Remember, the focal point was 10 centimeters out, so twice that would be about 20 centimeters right about there. Does it look plausible that we're looking at 27 centimeters approximately? Yeah, it looks pretty good. Next, we get the magnification, and that's negative di over do. It has that minus sign to keep track of the fact that the image is inverted. And I have negative 26.7 over my original object distance of 16. And I get a magnification of negative 1.67, meaning the scale of this thing has been blown up by a factor of 1.67, and it's been inverted. Next, we look at the converging lens, same focal length, but our object is inside the focus. DO is 6 centimeters. Focal length is 10, positive by convention. And the ray diagrams are definitely trickier when you're looking at a virtual image. I take a ray coming in parallel to the lens. That's refracted through the opposite focus. But because I end up with a bunch of diverging rays coming out the far side of the lens, I have to trace back and find a common origin for those. So I'm going to trace back. A ray that is coming from the direction of the near side focus is refracted parallel to the principal axis. And again, I've got to trace back to where the common origin is for these diverging rays. And then finally, a ray that goes through the center of the lens is unrefracted, but I've got to trace back to find this common origin. And those should all meet in the same place. And that's where we'll perceive that this object is. Now, it looks like it has a rather large magnification, and it's upright and virtual. Let's plug into the thin lens equation. I'm going to skip one of these steps this time and just solve for 1 over di. That's 1 over f minus 1 over do. And that's 1 over 10 minus 1 over 6. 1 over 6 is bigger than 1 over 10. That means we're going to get a negative out of this. And I get negative 0.0667. Then I take 1 over that answer and I've got di. And di is negative 15 centimeters. Remember that convention that a negative image distance is on the same side of the lens as the object started, which for us will always be the left-hand side. And then I can ask whether or not that looks reasonable in the picture. And roughly, yeah, it's not perfect, but my focal length is 10. I should have 10 plus half of 10 to get to negative 15 over here. It looks a little bit short, but it's because I didn't draw my diagram quite perfectly. And finally, I'm going to get the magnification for this, and that's negative di, which was negative 15, over do, which was 6. And this gives me a positive magnification, confirming that my image is upright. And my magnification is positive 2.5, so this thing will be blown up by a factor of 2.5 and will appear upright. Just a final note before we wrap things up. This second example is exactly what a magnifying glass is. You just take a converging lens and you put it close enough to what you want to look at so that the object is inside the focus, and you're going to see a magnified upright image of whatever the object is. If you find the physics content on Zach's lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.